Hello, boils and ghouls, and welcome to a special Spooktober edition of Just Hit Play, with your hosts Peter and Nick Cabral. If your stagnant, streamed music feed needs to be raised from the dead, then strap yourselves in for an intergenerational sonic journey to the dark side, where Peter and Nick introduce you to their favorite spooktastic songs.
Welcome to episode 23 of Just Hit Play. I'm your host, Peter. With me, as always, is my co-host, Nick. Nick, how are you?
I'm doing very well. Very, very well. We've had some extremely gloomy weather, which, in my opinion, perfectly fits the season. School's still kicking my ass a little bit, but, we're surviving. It's all good over here.
And we're still in the throes of Spooktober, so our songs this week have definitely a Halloween type theme. So that's continuing this week. So I'm really excited to keep going with these songs because I'm having a lot of fun trying to find Halloween type songs. And the song for next week is brilliant. So I'm really excited.
Oh, okay. Okay. Well, I won't get too much into what I have lined up for you next week, but I think you'll find it pretty spooky.
Cool. That's what I like. I like spooky. In our Brisbane studio is our engineer, sound magician, Darren. Darren, how are you?
I'm going good.
Thank you, Darren. So I think we're pretty much ready to get into this episode. It's a busy one. We're jam-packed. So tell us about the song that you picked for me.
Yeah, so for this next Spooktober episode, my mind immediately went to Zombies by Childish Gambino. Some of our viewers, or sorry, listeners, might know Childish Gambino better by his real name, Donald Glover. He's been in a ton of movies, TV shows, but what I love him for is his music. And this song is off his 2016 album, Awaken My Love. It should be pretty apparent why I chose this song for the Halloween theme. So, Darren, why don't you just hit play? So that's just a little bit of Zombies by Childish Gambino. Crazy instrumental. Really hits you right from the start. So what did you think of Zombies?
Yeah, I really love the sort of jazz, 70s jazz vibe the song has. I love the guitar work. It's such old school guitar work. And it's almost auto-tune free. There is a tiny bit of auto-tune in one of the lyrics, but I'll forgive Mr. Gambino for that. I love this song. It's such a great track.
Well, I'm pleased you'll let the auto-tune slide on this one. I think it's pretty minimal and, in my opinion, only adds to the song. But yeah, it's a really, really good one. So before we get into sort of the meaning of the song, I'll just give you some background on Childish Gambino. So prior to releasing this album, this came out 5 years ago, Childish Gambino, he was making strictly hip-hop music. Just classic hip-hop, rap-heavy stuff. But he started to become more and more experimental, album after album. And then all of a sudden, he drops this one, Awaken My Love. And it came so far out of left field. Some of our listeners might recognize the song Redbone. That was the big single from this album. Really great song. And that song really exemplifies the direction he's taken his music in. It's so infused with the jazz, like you said, very, very jazzy. A lot of funk, psychedelic rock. Like you can directly see where the influences are on this one. I'm not sure if you know Maggot Brain by Funkadelic, but that's got its DNA all over this song, this album.
It sure does.
Jimi Hendrix, Earth, Wind & Fire, Bootsy Collins. All those guys, it really shows in this album that he wanted to sort of pay homage to that area and incorporate it into his music.
You know, it's funny, Community, which Danny Glover?
wrong one.
Wrong Glover. Not related, apparently. Donald Glover was on Community, which is one of my favorite shows. And I had no idea that he had this in his locker, I must admit.
Yeah.
This is pretty good.
It's pretty wild. I mean, he got his start in the industry writing for SNL.
Yep.
And then started on Community. And throughout that, he was, you know, he was releasing his music, he was doing the stand-up sets, and from there, he's branched out to starring in major movies, like The Lion King, the new Star Wars, he was in a Star Wars movie, he was in a new Spider-Man movie, he's got his own TV show now, called Atlanta, which is fantastic,
great show.
He's just one of those guys that is uber creative, and everything he touches, you just see the creativity, and you know, you just see what his mind is like. It's fantastic.
Yeah, like when you sort of pigeonhole people sometimes, and Community, he was more of like a clown type of character that he played on the Community show, kind of ridiculous, and you sort of think that's who he is, but that's wasn't who he was at all. Like when he started releasing music with Childish Gambino, like the first song I remember, I think, was 3001.
Great song.
Which is the first song I ever heard from Childish Gambino, and I really dug that song, and then it just went on from there. I did not see that coming at all.
Yeah, and it was even more surprising being a fan who is so familiar with his older catalog, just to see that sort of growth, right? And he's the kind of person, because he's so involved in so many other creative pursuits, the music releases are kind of few and far between. It's like we've talked about on recent episodes, where artists nowadays, they have many other endeavors outside of music. It's not the sole thing they focus on anymore. In the 70s, 80s, artists would release an album and then tour it and then release a new one, right? That was the cycle. Now he's writing shows, he's acting in major movies, big budget franchise movies, while also trying to make new music. So all that to say, when there's such a long period of time off and then something releases and it's just completely different than what you expected, it's really, really cool. I like it a lot.
Yeah, and one of my favorite songs by Childish Gambino is This Is America, which I think is a very important song. I love the video, love the song. I think that is an example of what America was just as the Trump era was sort of starting. That is one of my favorite songs of all time, actually.
Yeah, that song had a really crazy moment in the cultural zeitgeist. It resonated with a lot of people. It reached a lot of ears, and the video was also, like you said, spectacular. Really complimented the song well.
Yeah, the video is uncomfortable, which is good. These are uncomfortable times that we're going through, so there's nothing wrong with making a video that confronts. I think that's important.
Yeah, absolutely. And speaking of uncomfortable, I think this song, specifically with its lyrics talking about zombies and whatnot, pretty uncomfortable, pretty scary. What do you think about that?
Yeah, that was my next question. So is the zombie thing, isn't it alliteration for something? Is he talking about ordinary people that go about their lives acting like zombies? Or is this a song written about zombies? I sort of couldn't tell where he was coming from.
Yeah. At face value, the lyrics are just talking about zombies, right? Classic horror characters and stuff. But I think my interpretation of the song is that he's talking about zombies as in people who sort of descend upon you when you're successful and sort of are vultures, and they leech off your success and enjoy, you know, the fruits of your labor. They enjoy your money, all of those things, without really contributing anything of their own. I believe that's what he's sort of going for on this one.
Right. Now, I was watching a documentary on pop music on Netflix, a really good documentary on pop music and Netflix. And they were talking about the Swedish influence on music. Do you know anything about the Swedish influence on music?
Other than ABBA, I don't know about the influence.
A lot of the hit songs that we know by, say, like Backstreet Boys, Britney Spears, even some of the artists today, are all recorded and written in Sweden or by Swedish people.
Oh, actually, I know of Max Martin. He's a Swedish producer, I think. He has so many producing credits on number one Billboard hits. It's kind of ridiculous, actually.
And it crosses over into Childish Gambino. There's a Swedish co-creator with Childish Gambino.
Yes, yes. Ludwig, I'm going to butcher this name.
Yes.
Ludwig Göransson.
That's correct.
Yeah, frequent collaborator. So he did the original music for Community. He was doing the score
right.
and stuff.
There you go. I did not know that. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So that's how they sort of linked up. And they, yeah, they've been frequent collaborators ever since. And actually, Ludwig Göransson, his career is on a pretty wild trajectory. He's getting he's scoring some really big movies now. He did the Black Panther movie.
That's right. He won a Grammy, I think, or an Oscar for that movie.
Oscar. Yeah, he won an Oscar for his work on that one.
Yeah.
So yeah, he's kind of going crazy right now. He's doing some great things. But yeah, it's those Swedish musicians are. It's true. They really are influencing a lot when you sit down and think about it.
Yeah, it's really interesting because if you watch it's on Netflix. I think it's called This Is Pop, and there's a specific episode about the Swedish influence on new music or Western culture music. It's really neat. So if you are interested in these kinds of things, I would go check out This Is Pop and specifically the Swedish episode. What has happened, how Sweden has influenced popular culture is incredible.
Yeah, and I think you can credit ABBA for all of that, right? I mean, without ABBA, would we really even have pop music? It's food for thought.
It's really incredible. And when I saw that half of Childish Gambino was a Swede, I'm like, what is going on? Like, yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, and that sort of has me thinking about a bigger topic, which is the importance of producers to pop music. Right behind every successful pop song is a really, really talented producer who did some magic on it. And I feel like some of the artists I like the most are ones who sort of stick with the same collaborators, and they hone and refine their sound with that, you know, one collaborator or a group of collaborators, and kind of build on that year over year. And that's exactly what Childish Gambino has done with Ludwig Göransson.
That is pretty consistent through popular culture. If you look back at like the 50s till now, you know, that is pretty much, there's always been these visionary producers that have influenced music throughout the ages. So you look at Brian Eno, who is going to be featured in our next act, Roxy Music, who is the keyboardist in Roxy Music. He produced a lot of David Bowie's albums from the 70s. Produced all U2's biggest albums, produced Coldplay, Talking Heads. He was the Talking Heads producer. So yeah, there's producers have influenced music quite nicely.
Yeah, it's funny. When you started talking about that, before you even said his name, my mind immediately went to Brian Eno. I'm not super familiar with his work. I know of his legacy, his importance to music, the way he should have, he shaped the sound, right? I know of that, but when you start listing off the groups and the people he's worked with, it's pretty spectacular.
Yeah, Brian Eno is one of those guys that will always go down in rock music history because he's produced like Octung Baby, Low by David Bowie, some of the best Talking Head albums, my favorite Coldplay album, which has, oh my God, that Bird, I think it's that Bird album. I can't remember the name of it off the top of my head. Do you know what I'm talking about?
Bird album.
Like Lovers in Japan is on it. Like there's some really good.
Oh, Viva La Vida.
Thank you. Yeah. So that's my favorite. I think Coldplay's best album, and he produced that one. So yeah, Brian Eno is up there with producers.
I also think that's Coldplay's best album.
It is their best album. Yeah.
One time not too long ago, I walked into my favorite record store in Guelph, and I was talking to the person who was running the store, and he asked me what kind of music I liked. Like he was like looking to give me a recommendation. And I said that the music I like the most, but have heard the least, is music that's influenced by 80s new wave and shoegaze. Mm. Like those are some really cool genres that I just haven't been exposed much to, but I like everything I've heard. And when I said that, he told me what I needed to do was look at Brian Eno and look at the groups he's worked with and go from there. He said Brian Eno was really, really influential in pushing those genres forward, and that I would enjoy, you know, anything with his fingerprints and DNA into it. And he was completely right. So all that to say, production is so important, and having a producer who is able to work with the vision of an artist, but take it to that next level to elevate it. It's really special and I think crucial.
Yeah, exactly. And going back to all the hits that the Swedish mob sort of come out with, it's, I don't know what it is about certain people's DNA, but how they can produce songs and just release hit after hit. It's incredible. Britney Spears owes her career, I should say, to the Swedish producers that she's worked with. Backstreet Boys are the same thing. All those early albums were released and produced in Sweden.
They've really got it down to a science.
They do.
They really do.
Yeah, they do. And when I saw Childish Gambino was being produced, it was a joint venture with a Swede that it sort of all brought it home. Yeah.
Yeah. There you go. Well, that's a great connection you made.
Yeah.
It's nice to, I always like highlighting the producers, sort of behind the scenes people.
Yeah.
I really like highlighting their contributions because I feel like not enough emphasis or value is placed on producers nowadays. I'm not sure it ever has been. So I really like when we get the opportunity to highlight that.
Now, this song Zombies is, I've not listened to the album in total that it comes from. Is this a pretty unique song of the album? Is it pretty consistent for what the album sounds like? What are your thoughts on that?
I would say the general vibe, the way the instrumental is, right? The funk, jazz, psychedelic rock, that is consistent throughout the album. And I would say just the overall ambition that the song is going for. It's pretty out there. Oh. That's consistent. Yeah, it's a really, really good album. I highly recommend that you just throw it on. It's one of those ones that you just have to throw on and let run all the way through because there's some long 6-7 minute songs that really rise and fall. And it's really special listening to it all.
Yeah, and I see there's some George Clinton influences on some of the songs as well. So George Clinton is old funk guy. So yeah, I'll definitely have to put that one on.
Highly recommend it.
Yeah. Should we ask Darren what he thought of Zombies?
I'd love to. Darren, what did you think?
Very Halloween-y. Very Halloween-y.
Yes, extremely Halloween-y.
Yep, that's Spooktober. Yep, really love that song. Nick, thank you so much for bringing that in.
Yeah, absolutely. No worries.
All right. Now, I have talked about this song in previous episodes about a creepy, creepy Roxy Music song. That's the song we're going to listen to now. I have some issues with this song. It kind of freaks me out a little bit, but Darren, just hit play and let's listen to a bit of it.
In every dream home, a heartache, and every step I take takes me further from heaven. Is there a heaven? I'd like to think so. Standards of living, they're rising daily. But home.
There is a little bit of In Every Dream, a Home, a Heartache, recorded by Roxy Music in 1973, the year of my birth. So it's a pretty good year. Nick, what did you think of In Every Dream, Home, a Heartache?
I couldn't even fathom that this was Brian Ferry,
right?
On this song. Such a stark contrast between his solo song we listened to and this. Yep. This is... like I said, I couldn't even fathom. Same guy.
Yep.
It's so very haunting song, right? Fits the Halloween theme to a T. It's so atmospheric. Yeah, that muted guitar in the back, like that's really, really well done. And there's some cool stuff going on a little bit lower in the mix that's panned to the side when you're listening in headphones. Loved that. Really, really good song. The lyrics are so striking. A lot of vivid imagery in the lyrics. And then, oh man, the climax of the song, so well executed. Like, you know it's coming, but so well done.
It just keeps building to that crunching guitar part that comes in later on in the song. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like I said, you know it's coming. If you've listened to music before with a song like this, you look at the time, you know, you see, okay, there's 5 minutes in this song. It's not going to be this for 5 minutes. There's going to be something really cool happening. And so on the first listen, I was just sitting there and I was thinking, okay, this is really cool. I like what's going on right now. But I know that once the drums come in, it's going to be awesome. And it was. It was really, really good.
what this song is about, and this is the creepiness that sort of comes out. And remember please, that this was recorded in 1973. It's a love song written about an inflatable doll.
Okay, so I wasn't sure if it was actually literal or if that was like a metaphor type. Okay.
Now, we're not talking like inflatable dolls that are coming out now. We're talking 70s inflatable dolls. So, right. Much more grimy and less sophisticated.
Yes, very, very grimy.
Yeah. There's like a line where, because it's an inflatable doll, there's a line that really freaks me out. It's like, my breath is inside you, and like, it's just creepy. Yeah, and it talks about like how the vinyl of her skin, and it's an odd song.
Very, very odd song. And like I said, not only does it sound so much different than the solo Brian Ferry song we listened to, the subject matter is completely different too. I'm not sure what happened to this man in between Roxy Music and his solo career, but wow, he changed, that's for sure. What he was singing about changed.
Well, in the build-up, the organ sort of, you hear it, the build-up of the song before the sort of like the guitars and drums kick in. That's all Brian Eno, by the way. Like, Brian Eno was the guy playing the organ and the keyboards. He was building that really creepy anticipation bit of the song. That's all Brian Eno.
There you go. That's really cool. And again, I feel like you need a producer of that caliber to pull off a drop, for lack of a better word, a drop or a climax like that. That's something that there's so many technical elements going into executing such a thing. You need a talented producer.
All right. So let me tell you how I came across this song. This is only a recent song for me. This isn't a song that I've known for a long time. In 2019, there's a TV show on Netflix called Mindhunter, which is about the FBI's involvement on tracking and figuring out what makes a serial killer. And this song was played over the season 2, episode 1, where it was depicting an American serial killer called Dennis Rader. And this song came on, and it just really creeped me out. The visuals of them trying to track this, serial killer, and the song. And I was like, who is this? Like, I had never heard a song like this before. And I did a SoundHound. So SoundHound is an app where you can click on it, and it listens to the song, and it tells you who recorded it. And it blew my mind. It, again, another reference to the song, because that is a line in the song, that it was Roxy Music.
Yeah. So Mindhunter, I've actually seen that show. Phenomenal. Really, really good watch.
Great show
for anyone wanting sort of that spooky Halloween vibe that we keep talking about. Definitely fits the season, the time of year. Really good show. But yeah, I don't remember. Like, obviously, I heard the song in the show, but I didn't have that impulse to go at it. To my library, but yeah, it's so good.
Now, did you notice in the song that it fades out then fades back in?
Yes. So I actually wanted to talk about that.
Yeah.
I don't know how I feel about that part, and I feel like they could have cut that out and just ended it the first time. What do you think? What's your read on that whole thing?
All right, I'm glad you brought that up. Okay. I think that the fade out is a very much an era, like a time of its era. And I'll explain to you what I mean. Technology today has made it that we don't need songs to fade out anymore. Like, can you think of a song that fades out like the old 60s and 70s songs? Can you think of one? Like, released now that fades out? Or
off the top of my head, not really.
No,
I'm sure if I shuffled my library, I could try and find one. But
songs generally come to a conclusion.
Yeah, yeah, they do.
I think there's a reason for that, why it happens now. And the reason for that is digital. You can stop a song because you don't need that vinyl where the vinyl has to play it out, because there's just space on the vinyl that needs to be filled.
Right. And when you're listening to a record, it's that whole experience, right? You're committing to listening to the whole album, the whole package. And I was going to say that last minute of the song where it kind of fades in and out, it kind of hurts the replay value of the song for me. And now that I'm hearing myself say these words, I feel like in the 70s and 80s, replay value wasn't really something that they were too concerned with.
No.
Right?
No, if you think about it, to listen to the song again, you needed to pick up the needle, move it back,
yeah,
and start it again. It wasn't just a click, right?
Right. Whereas now I throw the song in my playlist. I do a monthly playlist every month. I just throw all the new songs I'm listening to for the month in its own playlist. So I shuffle that, and the song, every time it hit the last minute, I kind of had that impulse to just go and skip the next one, because I would just be sitting in my car, you know, and it's like a minute of something that doesn't really add to the song too much, right? Yeah. You know what I mean?
All right.
So, yeah.
So now I want you to think about this. It's 1973. You're listening to a record. You're high.
Of course. It's 1973. And
you have your headphones on, and this song comes on, this creepy ass song comes on, and then it fades out, then it fades back in. Like, that's the mindset really that you should have. It was written for a specific audience in mind, a vinyl audience, right? Tapes weren't even a thing yet. Maybe 8-tracks might have been coming out around this time. But do you even know what an 8-track is?
Is it like a cassette tape?
Yeah, basically it's like a cassette tape that you would stick in an 8-track player in a car or a stereo, but it only has 8 tracks.
I see.
So if you had an album that had more than 8 tracks, you had to pick which 8 tracks would go on the 8-track.
Wow. Okay. Right. Yeah, that's a relic.
Yes. Thankfully, it's not around anymore. I remember it very well, but it's not around anymore. Yeah. So this song was written with a vinyl audience in mind, which is great because vinyl is outselling CDs now.
Oh, yeah. I collect vinyl now. It's in. It's back in.
So I'm going to touch on it a little bit deeper. Okay, so Nirvana, which released Nevermind in 1991, which was at the infancy of CDs taking over from vinyl. One of the reasons why Nirvana were so why they were so good for the CD era is because of the quiet to loud. Quiet to loud plays much better on digital than it does on vinyl.
Okay.
So Butch Vig, who was the producer of that album, Nevermind, talking about great producers, harnessed that digital power. They could go from very, very quiet, if you think about Smells Like Teen Spirit, very, very quiet to very, very loud in a very short space of time. And it sounds much better digitally than it sounds on vinyl.
That's really interesting.
Nirvana was built, as this song that we listened to was built for vinyl. Nirvana was built for that digital era that was just about to start.
I remember I read an article not too long ago about Rick Rubin, another very famous producer, very influential producer. He did a lot with the Red Hot Chili Peppers early on. Yep. And they said that what Rick Rubin was sort of doing was he started the quote unquote noise wars.
Yep.
And what that means is he would mix songs progressively higher and higher than other songs were being mixed at the time.
Yep.
So I'm not really sure how that relates to, you know, that sort of vinyl CD crossover era, but I'm sure it's something that only would have been possible because of digital and CDs.
Absolutely. And there's some great albums released in 1991, 1992, 1993 specifically, that followed that Nirvana model that just sounded great digitally, because vinyls was just pointless. When CDs came out, I just got rid of my vinyls. Like, I kept a couple, but there was just no point because it was just used cargo. Compared to now, where it's priceless now, if you look back at those old vinyls.
Well, what it is, when CDs came out, vinyls were outdated. They were obsolete. Yep. Now, because it's been so long, we're so far removed from the era of vinyl dominance that it's a novelty. It's a huge novelty now.
Yep.
And for people who are really into music, it hits a little bit differently putting a record on versus just pressing shuffle on your phone. Yeah. You know, it's got that ritual to it. It feels more intentional, purposeful. So their vinyl's having a crazy resurgence.
Yeah. I would love to hear this song played on a vinyl. I think with headphones on in my room, just listening to vinyl, I would love to hear this song.
Yeah. I feel like that would be a great experience for sure.
Yeah. So, I love this song. It creeps me out a little bit. but it's a great song.
No, it's certainly creepy, but very, very good song. Like I said, I think the replay value is kind of hurt for me. I'm indoctrinated by the digital era, right?
It's so interesting, isn't it? Yeah.
I'm all playlists, shuffle. So having that minute of kind of wasted space on a song, it's tough for me. But when I want to sit down and really have a purposeful listen to a song, a good song, this is one I'll go to. It's a great song.
Another song that does this sort of thing is Helter Skelter by the Beatles, that fades in and out, fades out, then comes back in. That's another song that does something similar.
Oh, yeah, you're right. It does. I like that song. I like U2's version better.
Really? There you go. You probably grew up with that song.
Exactly. Yeah, I heard the U2 version before I ever heard the Beatles one, courtesy of my father.
Yeah. Yeah. No, I love Helter Skelter. Darren, what did you think of In Every Dream Home, A Heartache?
Yeah, it was an okay song.
Thank you, Darren. All right, let's move on to our next segment. This Week in Music History. All right, so let's see what was number one in the year 2000. It was, unfortunately, that Christina Aguilera song.
Oh, not again.
Yeah, I think it's number one for 4 weeks, so this is week number two. Number two was Madonna, Music.
Had staying power.
Apparently it had staying power. So I was like, well, I don't want to play that song again. Then I started looking down the charts, and the number 14 song that week was Shake Your Ass by Mystical. Darren, play it. Shake your ass. Watch yourself. Shake your ass. Show me what you're working with. Shake your ass. I love that song so much. I love that Mystical song. Look, I don't know I don't know if you've ever heard that song before, but
I've never heard it. Yeah. If I was in a dingy basement club in the year 2000 and I'd had a couple Jaeger bombs, I think I would really enjoy listening to that song.
Yeah.
But I think that's about it. I think that's the only time I would enjoy that song.
At the time, you would, every once in a while, you'll hear someone just go, shake your ass. Like, you'll just hear it. Like, like if someone was walking by, that would be said to them. It sort of became part of the year 2000, what people would say to strangers walking by.
Nice, nice.
Yes. Thankfully, we have a better song that was in 1973. The number one song was Higher Ground by Stevie Wonder. Darren, just hit play. All right. Much better song.
You win.
Yeah, that's a great song, but it's one of my favorite Stevie Wonder songs. I don't know if you've ever heard Higher Ground.
I have.
But yeah, amazing song. Yeah,
that is a classic. That is an absolute classic. Just when Darren played that snippet, my foot just got a mind of its own and started tapping to it. It's so good.
Such a great track. Yeah. So yeah, that's the number 14 song in the year 2000 and the number one song in the year 1973, respectively. So there you go. So what do you got going on for the rest of your week?
Cool is doing its thing, not being nice to me, but I'm headed up to Toronto for the weekend, going to hang out with some of my friends who live down there. So that's really nice. I'm always really excited to get a chance to go in and enjoy what Toronto has to offer for someone in their early 20s. That'll be a really good time.
Yeah, cool. That sounds like fun. I don't have much going on this week. Me and Darren are photographing a soccer tournament tomorrow.
Oh, very nice.
But it might rain, so we're fingers crossed that it doesn't rain.
Speaking of soccer, I wish Manchester United the best of luck this week, but I think we're going to crush you guys.
It's Sunday / my Monday, I think we're playing, isn't it?
Random topic. when are those games for you in Australia? Those early morning Premier League games?
The best times are about 9:30. The worst times are about 3 to 4 a.m. And then every once in a while, you'll get like a 5:30 game. So the Champions League usually starts about 5 a.m. for us, which isn't too bad. But yeah, those 3 to 4 hour in the morning games are pretty bad.
Wow. The The struggle of being a Premier League fan in Australia.
Yes, it's real. What song? Do you have a song for me to listen to next week?
I do. So I said at the start of this episode that you're really going to be spooked by this song. I didn't mean that in the literal sense. I think this one's going to challenge you. It's
cool.
Rap Saved Me by 21 Savage, Offset, produced by Metro Boomin, and featuring Quavo. So it's three different people rapping on the song. That's challenge number one for you, discerning the features. There's some auto-tune. I'm not going to lie to you. There's some auto-tune. But it's also, it was released on a special Halloween project.
Cool.
It's got some Halloween atmospheric synths and stuff. So it does fit the theme, but it might scare you a little bit.
Cool. I don't know any of these people, so I'll give it a go. And your song is Bela Lugosi Is Dead by Bauhaus.
Oh, okay. Very nice.
Have you ever heard of Bauhaus?
The name sounds familiar, yeah, but yeah. I can tell from the song name that, yeah, Halloween for sure. Shout out Bela Lugosi.
This is goth rock at its finest.
Fantastic.
Okay, and we have our independent artist this week. It's King Ibis with their song Touch. King Ibis fuses the potent personal lyrics of lead singer Nadine Burchill to the slick instrumental work of guitarist Matthew Oakley, bassist Samantha Goddard, and drummer John McAndrew, crafting endlessly replayable earworms that deliver deeply personal stories in a stylish pop package. I love the song. Touch is a really, really cool song. So, Nick, thank you very much, and we'll talk to you next week.
You got it. See you then.
Darren, just hit play.
You've been listening to Just Hit Play. To contact your hosts, Peter and Nick, or to be featured on an episode as musical talent, email justhitplay7300@gmail.com. Keep up to date with news and announcements by following on Instagram and Facebook, linked in the show notes. Subscribe on your favorite podcatcher to tune in next week for more Sonic Delights. And if you can't wait till then, check out the Just Hit playlist on Spotify, linked in the show notes. A special thanks to me, Angie Moss, for the theme song, featured in the soundtrack to Strange Breed, a Moss Siblings production, linked in the show notes. And thank you for listening.